Hey, it's Fran, again, in the lab, yada yada. I know a lot of people were upset I didn't do that in the first part of this series, but we're in part three of a potentially four-parter. I don't think I'm going to finish this in the next hour of video. We're going to get into the point-to-point part of the whole project, wiring it together, the core of the main chassis that I assembled all the hardware in. Episode 2. So yeah, it's looks pretty yeah. We're gonna do this. Yep. I don't know. A lot of writing. So I've kind of been going off script for some of this build, but in this particular part I think it's gonna be important that I go step by step in the instructions and not miss anything. Because it's, I don't want to cross any wires or get any of the high voltage on the low voltage or vice versa. That would be bad news. Not that I intend on doing that. lots of views and comments. It looks like this series is kind of popular. People are digging the long format and the sort of sit down and do it yourself so that you can kind of imagine doing the same thing. lots of comments around certain things, like one thing that people talked about a lot is the old paper electrolytic capacitors. Why don't you use this? I bet you this will last longer than those newfangled caps. Well, you know, in some sense, older technologies might outlast newer. Vacuum tubes will run a really long time if you run them under current and such, but on the other hand, there are certain things like paper electrolytic capacitors that are a technology that is absolutely not tough, and it's almost guaranteed that this will fail. Even if I were to test it and it tested fine or within spec, as soon as you put, 120 volts on this, or 150 volts, and put it under load for a while, the dielectric is just going to break down. It's probably dried out, and it's just a matter of putting current through it before you get a fail. And you don't want one of these to fail after you've installed it. I mean, there's no way that I was going to solder this in place and solder the lugs and get it in the assembly and have just so that after I run the thing for like an hour, it would just conk out and I'd have to tear it out and do exactly what I ended up doing, which is replacing it with some modern high voltage electrolytics. Yeah, I can honestly say I don't have anything from this era that still has the original paper electrolytics in. I mean, the higher end stuff like the Tektronix scopes and stuff like that, they've got really good film caps. Those will last forever. Film caps even like this Sprague, I'll probably use that. The dry film caps, it's a different kind of animal than the electrolytics, which require that sort of wet paper in there. So, if you want to use them in your projects, if it looks shiny and new and you want to put it in your Heathkit, more power to you. You go and do that. You don't have to follow my lead. It's just that I've spent a lifetime replacing these caps and I'm not going to put a 40-year-old capacitor, electrolytic capacitor in a new build. I'm a little too experienced to do that. Lots of suggestions about deoxing contacts and there's lots of ways you can do it. I use sandpaper on this because I'm actually going to solder to those connections. And people are like, "Oh, you're going to sand through the plating." Well, that's sort of the idea. I sanded through the plating to get down to the copper. And I just basically just soldered directly to the copper rather than, I basically sanded away the tin plating and the silver plating and just went right down until I saw the shiny copper, soldered right to that. So, yeah, it was intentional. I wasn't going to bother with trying to find some a layer of silver that is untarnished. Actually, that tarnish kind of went all the way through the silver plating. I don't think I hit any untarnished silver. It's sort of the the whole, you know, it's probably like a few molecules thick silver, and it was all oxidized all the way through. Oh yeah, so the other thing is on my dexterity. Well, the comments about my dexterity, because I commented on a little bit. My shakiness isn't because of stage fright or anything like that. I have a permanent tremor, so it, you know, started to kick up around my 40s, and I, you know, chalk it up to lifelong chemical exposure, because I've worked a lot with every kind of volatile organic compound you can imagine, methyl ethyl ketone, carbon tetrachloride, back when they used to use that, toluene, acetone, turpentine, you name it. So, these days, I mean, since my early 40s, I take a lot of precautions to limit my exposure to chemicals, solvents, and lead, and such. So, once you get long-term exposure, the damage is there. So, yeah, if you're young and sort of cavalier about it, I'm not going to wear a respirator when I paint, I'm not going to wear gloves. I'll get the paint all over my hands. Then I'll just wash off my hands with turpentine or mech or something like that. It'll be fine, you know. Or, yeah, I'll wash off my skin with acetone. Yeah, that'll be fine. Yeah, well, you know, you do that enough and gets into the body, gets into the cells, and you get permanent nerve damage. So, if you're cavalier in your 20s, by the time you get to your 40s, you're like, well, if I'd only done this, then I'd still be able to do that. But yeah, my dexterity is such that, you know, if I hold a tool loosely, I can, if I relax all my muscles, I can kind of get that. But as I start to apply muscle tension, it's just, so if you see a lot of like my woodworking videos, I'm holding something heavy like a drill, it'll be like all over the place. It's just, that's the way it is. So I lost my dexterity, especially when using tools. But anyway, that's enough of that. I mean, this is a total downer now. Let's get into the build. I think people commented too about my gloves being too large, that it should be a tight fit and everything. Well, the problem with the tight fit on the gloves is that I use nitrile gloves, and there's two issues. One is that most of the places where I buy nitrile gloves, they have one size fits all, which is super large. And the other is if you're doing work like this where you're not doing wet work and you want to, you know, unless you want to throw out the gloves every time that you need to take them off to leave the bench, if they're larger like this, you lose the dexterity, but you can just take them off. Whereas if I special ordered small sized nitrile gloves that would fit tight and I get the dexterity, well, you got to turn them inside out and then you got to blow through them and everything. I just, you know, I get tired of doing that. So I sacrifice that. They don't look cool, but they're easy to take off, and I can reuse them. Okay, enough of that. So here's the wire. Now the probe wire I'm probably going to use because that's, you know, thick PVC insulated. Yeah. But this older PVC wire they want me to cut up. I'd rather use my stock of silver Teflon, because this stuff is just, this is my stock aircraft grade silver Teflon wire. This is the absolute bomb, and I'll probably use this instead for the internal hookups. It requires a very special tool, silver Teflon wire. You need a special tool to cut it and strip it, and you know, you might look at this, this isn't a specialized tool, because I can get that in any catalog. They sell these on eBay. Well, yeah, sure. You get ones that look like this, but they won't work with Teflon, because you need a special type of interlock gripper on this side to actually hold the Teflon. The regular type strippers, they have kind of a smooth inner flange on this side. The one for Teflon, it's got this really aggressive serrated edge in here. Yeah, I don't know if it'll show up. Yeah, that's a really aggressive edge, and that digs in a little bit to the Teflon insulation, actually holds onto it while you separate it. So I actually paid a lot more to have that special part, but I had another pair of these before when I started using Teflon wire that it looked exactly the same, but it wouldn't hold the wire at all. But you know, we got the special stripper, we got the Teflon wire. I'm going to use Teflon. It also says I'm going to be needing some slip-on insulation for the resistors and some of the capacitors. The PVC, I'm assuming it was PVC, sleeving that they included with the kit, it had disintegrated. It had, you know, turned into an oily mess. So I'm going to substitute some sleeving out of my own stock. I've got a really long reel of this sleeving that worked just fine. So, yeah, no problems. All right, so I just sanded that off. And again, I just sanded off the silver coating, and here's the copper. So now it's just a copper contact. Yeah, both people say, oh, you should use Scotch-Brite for that. Well, yeah, I would, but unfortunately my lab is half packed up in the Scotch-Brite and steel wool and other stuff. I crated that up and sent it over to the wood shop, so it's not actually... I looked around, it's like I ended up that I had packed it all up. I didn't even have like a piece lying around, which is what I usually have, but I must have chucked it for some reason, so... Very thin coating of silver, because I'm actually just rubbing the rest of it off with paper towel, so... Yeah, there's like no shiny silver underneath, that's just like a couple molecules of silver right on copper. Oh well. I'll consider to that. That's not a problem. Alright. That's good. Tastes good. Alright. No worries. We'll use that. It does have some... Did it include bare wire? Alright. First thing they want to do is connect one end of the 2-inch length of bare wire. Yeah, we're not going to be using metric on this one. Two-inch length of bare wire. Pin 3 of the V1 tube socket, which is this one right here. Feed the other end through the center ground lug. Yeah. So, counting clockwise from the bottom, 1, 2, 3, and we're going to go through the center ground lug here, and then on through pin 9. Turn on the fans. Make it easy on myself. This first. Pin 3 through center lug through pin 9. Lug to all right, and that goes to the chassis ground there. Right. Always a good idea to check it twice, solder once, to take my own version of the old carpenter's phrase, measure twice, cut once. Check the Heathkit list twice and solder once. Okay, so pin 3, right, feed through the center ground lug, through pin 9. Then to lug 2 to the ground. Okay. Looks all right. Hit it with some extra flux. I think people ask me, what kind of liquid flux do you use? And the stuff that I'm putting in my pen, I just basically just bought it. It's number 80 water soluble. So it's water soluble flux. Mm-hmm. That's what I keep in the pen. And it's just a regular, you know. I mean, you can get these felt-tip refillable flux pens, you know, refill it. I just keep it inside of, here's the solder, I keep it in like that, and it just keeps it, because if you lay it down, it'll tend to leak, So I just, you know, leave it like that. No worries. Fume extractor nearby. I tell you, the fume extractor is a really makes a huge difference. And actually, in addition to the fume extractor, I'll show real quick. I have the Heiko extractor, but I've actually added to it this HEPA filtering piece, just to take the particulates out. In addition to having the thick carbon filter behind it, so it makes a big difference, I think, with the you know, fine airborne particulates having the HEPA filter. And then next to the iron, behind the iron, I have this little baffle I taped to it, but this is just a small desktop HEPA filter that I, you know, it basically just extracts the fumes coming off, because when you solder and then you melt some solder, right, and then put the iron away, if you didn't have something to suck that up, that really just blows all, that fills up the room. Every time you put the soldering iron back, it just continues to smolder. So I found putting the HEPA filter here, it just sucks all the fumes in there, and it's got a carbon filter plus the HEPA, and that blows the exhaust straight up. So the combination of the extractor plus the HEPA filter for the idling soldering iron is a good combination. When I was doing production soldering, I had one of those large type flat front HEPA filters that I had sat on the desk right in front of the soldering station, and so no matter where I was, it created this laminar flow of air, because it was like a, you know, 18 inch wide, you know, by 14 inch tall filter, and it would just move all the air across the desk like this, and, you know, remove all the fumes continuously that way. So whichever way you want to do it, you know, getting the fumes away from your face, that's that's the way to go. There's number one. All right, I'm going to pencil these off as I do them. And yeah, for those at home, I'm going to use America's pencil, USA Gold. It's not a Palomino Blackwing, but for shop use, I do think America's pencil's my favorite American-made pencil. And since this is a Heathkit, how fitting to use a good American pencil. Scratch that off. Number one, okay. Scratched off number one. Step number two. Cut 2 6-inch lengths of hookup wire. Strip both ends. Twist the wires together and connect one pair to pin three. Okay, we're going to do the twisted pairs for the filaments. I know that's what they're getting at, so. All right. Well, you know what? This is a good opportunity, since I'm cutting and stripping wire. It's a good opportunity for me to show off my wire stripping set. I showed this earlier about how to strip wire like a boss. This is a system I made for cutting and stripping production wire a long time ago, so it's going to make it a lot easier to do this. So I have cut into lengths which I've marked, like this is 6 inches, 6.0, so it makes it super easy to cut lengths of wire, sort of hold the end and 6 inches. it's just so slick. It's one of the coolest things about the automatic wire stripper. Focus on this. Come on, focus on this. Come on, focus on this. So I wanted to focus on this, and so I had to take that thing from the background to get to focus on that. So yeah, there you go. Oh, it's so quick, so easy. I love the automatic wire stripper. It's just so easy to do. Nice and clean. Autofocus hell. Yeah, my big criticism of this new Canon, the XA11, is the autofocus. It just does not have intelligent autofocus. And I even have the facial tracking shut off so that it'll kind of look for other things, but it just will not focus on just the closest object. It's just won't do it. One twisted pair. Connect one wire to pin 3 of S2, V2, okay. Pin 3 and pin 4. Okay, so we're moving over the filaments. The green wires from the transformer, those are the filament wires. So, and I knew I'd have to solder 2 more connections in those pins. So, that in there. All right. And we're going to move that over to the next tube. The other ends are going to go into pin 4 and 5. I'm going to count them clockwise from the bottom. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 and 5 are going to be right here. I'm going to bring that around from the back. It doesn't matter which way we go, because they're AC filaments, so there's no polarity. I'm just going to use one at a time, it's going to be easier. There's my tremor. There we go. The filament connections, and I'm leaving those top two open because I'm going to have to jump those over to the I-tube. But the I-tube's in a different assembly, so we're not going to be, we'll be connecting that on another page, I'm sure. We'll be doing that on the next set of pages, but those lugs are there for that when we do that. All right. And so, okay, that's step 2. Cross that out. Alright. Next is connect one end of 4.5-inch length of hookup wire. Okay, so we're going to have to 4.5. Let's see. 4.5 inches. And the straw system is really good. I highly recommend it. So get that and strip it. All right. Gotta love the auto strippers. Okay, 4.5-inch wire. Pin 1 of S1, V2. Okay. And connect the other end to lug 3, the filter condenser C7. Uh-huh. So we're gonna do it over here. Okay. So this wire is going to connect the pin 1 of V1 to the condenser, but because I made up my own condenser, they're telling that it's kind of weird because there's nowhere in the instructions, if I were to assemble this kit with this condenser, there's nowhere in the instructions to say what number the pins were, because when originally it told you just to install the condenser, right? But the pins, they're not numbered. There's a square symbol, triangle symbol, and no symbol for the 50, 50, and 20 microfarad. And but it, even though it shows here on the you could put that in any orientation that you want in the plate, There's no like key. It's not keyed. Okay. Pin one is the square. I can see it there now. That's, here's this tiny little square there. And a tiny little record. So that's the square and the triangle. Okay, so pin one is a square, two is a triangle, three is no symbol. Okay. So translate that to that. So pin one is 50, pin two is 50, pin three is 20. All right, 50, and that's the 20. All right, that lug's gonna be the 50, that's gonna be the 50, that's gonna be the 20, and yeah. All right, cool. And just verify that on the schematic. All right, okay. Okay, so in the schematic, you see the 250s are right here. All right, so you got 150, and you got a 10K resistor between the two. So you got 150 going up to this leg, this pin 6 on the pentode. And it'll also go over to, up to, it's also pin 1 and 6. Well, it's going to the current limiting resistors, but it's, yeah, okay. So that's going to the B plus, and this 50 is, that's 138 volts. That's going to the I-tube. All right, so, yeah, that makes sense. And then the 20, the 20 is, mentioning too here, the center tapped filament, got the center tap there. They put that to ground, but actually, you know, in a really good balance, in a really good audio circuit, you would have, instead of tacking that right to ground, you would have a potentiometer, like a 1 meg pot or whatever, that would be tied to either leg of the transformer and then have an adjustable center tap so you could adjust the hum. It's not as reliable for audio as if you can like actually center it on the center tap on the transformer. But this transformer doesn't have any center taps, so obviously it's not possible to do that. But I guess you could use a voltage divider. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, that's yeah, that's another thing that you can do. Like if I wanted to make this really high fidelity, I could take that and put it to a pot that would just go to either leg, and I could actually tune out the hum for the center. Anyway, but I'm not going to bother doing that. I'll just tie it to ground. Looking for the 20. Oh. All right. Now, there it is. There's the 20. Right there. It's going off the cathode, so yeah, okay. Yeah, that makes sense. The cathode bias. All right. That's fine. All right, no problem. I'm wasting a lot of tape, virtual tape. All right, I see why this is gonna take 4 days to do. Look at that. It goes to pin one, okay, other side, lug three of condenser C7. Since there is no lug here, by pure coincidence, I actually got the orientation of everything correct. Actually, just by pure happenstance, I wasn't planning on it, but actually put the 20 right in the position where it was supposed to be, after all. So, there you go.
Right.
I'm going to leave that lead there because I'm going to have to solder a resistor there. So I'm not going to trim these until I finish all the hookups. All right, next, connect one lead of 330 ohm resistor, orange, orange, brown, to lug 3 of S2.
Ooh.
All right. Check the... check the value on that. 341. That's not too bad. It's still kind of within spec. Yeah. So some people will comment about, oh, you know, those carbon composite resistors, you know, they'll change value. They'll, you know, it's true. But for something like this, they're not going to be off enough to affect performance. So. Alright, this goes from lug 3 of S2 to C7. Okay, yeah, this is the 330 ohm. That's on the schematic for the cathode biasing. Okay, and the other is going to go to chassis ground. So, yes, alright. I'm double checking all these connections against the schematic just to make sure that I'm not getting things mixed up. I'm gonna improvise a little bit here because I didn't put the no solder lugs to solder to because I didn't use the original condenser, so I'm just gonna have to solder this down to the plate like I did on the other side. Already put some flux on there. No worries. Now I can trim that off. Right. Cross that off. Okay. Next step is to connect one lead of a 10k ohm resistor, brown, black, orange, to lug 1 of C7. Okay. Brown, black, orange. One of my favorite resistor values. 10k. Use a 10k in just about everything that I ever build. It always ends up being like something I put into everything. It's always a 10k resistor. 11K. So yeah, again, that's, you know, about 10% off. So still within spec. No worries. All right. This little guy is going to go between lug 1 of C7, which is the 50 here, and at the other side to lug 2. This is the going to be the resistor, 10k resistor, between the two condensers here. So it's going to be right there in the two. That other condenser we put in right here, so part of the cathode bias on that. So, alright, so we're going to put it in between these two condensers to split the power supply. Leads are kind of thick. Again, you don't want to bend these leads like right up against the resistor. Need a little bit of wiggle room. So. All right, since I did a little curly Q there. Extra crimp with the really heavy pliers. Okay. looks good. All right, cross that one off. I want a 5-inch length of wire. Grab my 5-inch tube. Right, 5-inch wire, and one side's going to go to lug 2 of the capacitor, which is right. It's coming from the 50. All right, we're going to leave that hang. Okay, it's going to be going to the switches in the front. So let's connect it to pin 2 to this 50, and let it hang. Okay. So when I finish assembling the chassis, we're going to have a few wires that are just going to be hanging off the chassis to be hooked up after we do final assembly. There we go. And I'm just going to let that hang there. That's going to go to the front panel later on. Okay, so I did that. Alright, connect the lead of another 330K. 330K ohm resistor, orange, yellow, right here. And hook that up to pin 2 of socket V1, the other side to the ground lug W on S1. Pin 2, which is this one right here, and it's going to go to the ground lug. Well, I don't have a ground lug here, but I'm going to have to create one. So, again, because those lugs aren't there because they were part of the can capacitor, so no worries. All right, so I'm going to put that underneath. I have another thing going through there, so. Ran out of hands. Okay. Need that clamp on there. Another reason forceps are handy. It can be a third hand when you need it. And the other end of that's going to go to the ground on the capacitor. I'm going to cut that down. Bend it around. Tack it right down there. Come on, don't go cold on me. This is a really good heat sink. Alright, that's it. Make sure it's not a cold joint. Give it a good wiggle. And that's tacked down. No worries. Okay. Got that one done. Almost done page 12. Let's see. Last step on page 12 is to connect one lead of a 47K ohm resistor, yellow, violet, orange. Another one of my favorite values. Ah, missing a resistor, yellow, violet, orange. I don't have a 47K resistor in amongst my resistors. Alrighty. So I just took an inventory of the resistors because I just used 3 and I've got a bunch left here. I redid the inventory and there's one 47K ohm that I do not have in carbon composite. So why that one's missing? Well, that's kind of typical Heathkit fare. I have crates full of vintage carbon composite resistors, and they're all in storage because, as you know, or maybe you don't know, I've been tearing apart my lab for the move, and even though I thought I had put aside a crate of assorted parts, it seems that that ended up over there in storage too, so all of my resistors are in storage, but these are some of my actually vintage Heathkit resistors. When I got my first Heathkit, they gave me a soldering lesson, and part of that soldering lesson, the guy handed me a a bare circuit board and a fistful of quarter watt carbon composite resistors to practice soldering at home. And I still have a bunch of them here, but I still use them occasionally, picking through. I'm looking for, I don't see exact value. Maybe I can, I'd hate to have to go all the way over to the storage facility just to get one resistor, but maybe I can cobble together the value from two that I got here. So this 47K resistor, it's going to be used as a current limiting resistor on one of the triodes. It's not going to be too critical. I have a couple of 100K that if I tie them together, they're a little over, it'll be like 52K, but it's going to be fine for this particular application. I really don't care if it's a little tiny less loud than it would have been. I'm just going to make up a resistor from these 200Ks. To attach a little extension wire one side of that, because it's going to have to go from pin 1 here to here. So I'm going to make a little wire extension. Anywhere near 50K, we should be fine. It's slippery. 53, it's a bit over. I'm gonna use it. It'll be fine. It'll just be a little more limiting, but I'm not worried about that at all. I'm gonna have to have a couple more components in that lug. I'm just gonna use the bottom part. Point, I have to use tools because it's just getting too tight to get fingers in there. All right, we've completed all of page 12. Got all that marked off, so yeah, and we continue. So we're on to page 13, and the first thing I've got here is, where's that sleeve? Page 13, connect the one lead of a 68K ohm resistor, blue, gray, orange, to pin 6 of V1. It's V1 here, so move it to the other side to lug 2 of C7, which is right here. Gonna need a couple pieces of insulation, like about so. It's gonna come out here, so maybe trim those back a little bit. Doesn't have to be that much insulation. Six. sure there are some people watching this video. I haven't edited this down, but I've been at this a while. I'm sure that some people watching this video are thinking that this is the equivalent of watching paint dry. And you might be right. But, you know, there are people who do like to watch paint dry. Yeah. Okay, so the 68K is the current limiting resistor on the first triode, that 12AX7A, dual triode, and that 52K that I made up for the 47 is for the second anode in that dual triode, so yeah, so it looks like it's going to be correct, and solder that first. And that's the last connection on there, so I can cut that off. Alright, coming together. Cross that one off. Next is to, we're going to connect a cap. 0.005 microfarads. So I get a 5 nano. 5 nano here. And check these. Close enough. I'll take that. And this guy, we're going to put it on pin 2 of V1, and it's going to pop over to pin 6. Shorten the leads a little. Okay, I'm going to do these one at a time. So I'm going to curl that up. Make a good physical joint. Third hand here. Double checking each time before I solder. Double check the drawing. Another side of that, because I know this resistor. It's going over here again. That it's going to the anode. With that triode. Making sure I stay clear of the ground. Again, I kept that upper lug open so I could get that through there. Check it out in three dimensions, make sure there's no conflicts. Alright. All right, cross that one out. Now we gotta get a 1K, brown, black, red, for those playing at home. Okay, one end through lug 3 of level control R1. Just noticed on the potentiometer how the center lug is tarnished and the outer ones aren't, so it's like they have different coating on the center lug than the side lug, so. I have to contact with it. All right. I see shiny, okay. Seems solderable. But we're not actually going to solder that lug just now. I just had to get that out of the way before I start soldering to these connections here. It's going to be lug 3. It's going to be counterclockwise lug. Wrap around the control solder lug Y. Okay, it's the control lug. So we're going to actually, this makes sense because the full counterclockwise position is usually, you know, where you want the volume to be all the way down. They're going to ground that out. So this is actually going to make a connection to the ground on that side. So basically, we're just going to. It's going to kill two birds with one stone. It's going to ground out the full counterclockwise lug on the potentiometer for the volume control, and at the same time it's going to create a grounding point to bring down this 1K value from pin 8 which is going to be, yeah, so right here. So, so it's going to be, again, the cathode resistor right there. So there's the grounding point, so, yep. I'm going to sand the lead just so that we get a good connection. I shouldn't solder that because they've got, they're going to use that, yeah, okay. I'm going to remove that solder because even though it tells me to solder that joint, there's only one lug there, and it's, I'm seeing, looking ahead at the drawing, I can see I'm going to have to put another resistor to that point, so I'm going to suck the solder out of that. There's still solder on that connection, it should hold. But I've opened up the, okay. And I'm gonna kind of gently bring that around here and give it a good wrap around. I'm doing a torque on the, resistor itself, because again, you don't want to damage the where the lead is connected to the resistor. You don't want to, definitely don't want to be torquing it by the resistor. So wrapped around like that, tack that down, the grounding area there. Yeah, all that. Oh, that's beautiful. That's a pretty one. And then that guy's gonna come around. Again, I don't want to bend it out the resistor. Okay. That's gonna come around to pin 3, so I'm gonna lug 8. Oh, I see. Yeah, okay. I was looking at the drawing here, and I was looking at, because it said to wrap around here, and I'm looking at this because it told me to do the wrap around and put to pin 8, but that's actually, even though it told me to wrap that around wrap around the control solder lug and connect to pin 8, depiction in the drawing is that the 330K resistor is wrapped around the controller. It doesn't make a difference, but it's just in the drawing they have the 330K wrapped around and not the 1K, but in the description they tell you to wrap the 1K around. They're both going to ground. It's not going to make a difference, but it is a little bit confusing. But anyway, yeah, so I did that. And the next is going to be the 330K. Again, to the grounding point there, and then to pin 7, which is going to be for the grid bias. Yeah, right here. That's the grid bias for the first triode there, pin 7. Yeah, pull this away. Get the K ohm, orange, orange, yellow. That's pretty bang on. 331.5K, that's pretty good. And that's all we're gonna need for this lug, so I'm gonna just cap that off. Okay. So. very careful not to damage these resistors because I'd have to go to storage to get replacements. Going to pin 7. And knock that off. Now, next we got another 5 nano cap. Oh, come on. Oops, if I get it in the right function. It's close enough. There you go. The 1 meg center, so this for the center wiper on the pot to the grid, pin 7. So it's getting to be like getting a little bit of a twister here. Again, I don't want to stress the leads at the resistors. So I got 1 lead that's going to go in there. Okay. The only connection I got here, so I'm just going to solder that down. Oh, I did not flex that. Alright. That took. Being very careful not to stress the cap. Trim that. There. It's going to go to pin 7. Then in the leads. Come on. Ah. Double check that. Yep. Yep. Most can be bent there. Okay. Alright, there we go. No worries. Alright. Cross that off. Gonna get another 5 nano. Putting it on the capacitor test function this time. That's good enough. And that one, I'm gonna go from the slug here to slug 1. Terminal strict X. That's this lug right here. So obviously we're going to have another connection on that lug. Yeah, here it is right here. Yeah. So there it is there. It's going from the pot to this junction right here. That's going to be for the probe. Okay, so that's going to be the probe comes in here. Yep, okay. Makes sense. So here's the probe, signal probe, and that's going to go through this 0.005. Yeah, and that's going to buffer it to the pot. The pot's just going to be like a 1 meg to ground, and then the tap off of that is going to bring the signal around here to the grid, right? And then we got the 330K there. That's providing the grid bias. Right, okay. This looks pretty straightforward. So these leads are going to be really short. Side I'm gonna bend up. It's getting real tight. Ah. Get that close to the leave a little bit of lead spacing there. Yeah. I'm not going to close up that lug because there's almost certainly I've got to solder something else to that. I can't quite see it here, but I know that there's going to be another connection there because that's going to be where the probe is going to connect, so I'm just going to solder it. So that's it's soldered, but I'm leaving the lug open because I'm going to have to put another wire through there. So Yeah, not a lot of room to work now. Lots of places where you could short something out if you're not paying attention, so. Alright, the next, well, it's gonna be a point 001. Might as well just test all these caps rather than doing them individually. 0.95, 99 fair, that's close enough. I'm gonna check the others while, you know. I should have checked them all at the same time originally, but. You know, wasn't really thinking ahead. Ooh. Oh, 1.02 nanos, that's right on. And ...1.06 nanos. Also, not bad at all. They're all fine. So, we got this guy. It's gonna go... connect one to condenser pin one of socket V1. So, pin one, that's where we put that, that 52K, and it's gonna jumper from there to, I believe, the ground. To lug two of terminal strip X, yes, it's gonna be ground. That makes sense. That's gonna be short one. So this is gonna be a little bypass cap. I actually just wipe the tarnish off of these capacitor leads, no worries. Put it value side up. Right. And I'm going to have to put another connection there, so I'm not going to solder that. Looks like this is the only other connection on the solder lug here, so I'm gonna solder here. but I'm gonna leave it open on the other. I'm not gonna solder this lug because I've got another connection here by the drawing. That's where that metal film cap is gonna go. So I'm gonna leave that open. So this is gonna go in next, the metal film cap. Let's see, it's 0.01 microfarad plus or minus 10%. So let's see how good it does after all these years. 13, that's a little bit over 13 nanos. So that's a bit more than 10% over. Doesn't really matter. But it looks like it's a bit overwound. Film caps they're not going to drift. But I'll use it. It's going to be fine. It doesn't say to put sleeving on, but it's such a long throw that I think that I am going to put sleeving on it. Because it's... yeah. And the other end's going to be going in there, so it's going to be really a pin too. Pin 2 on the pentode. So, yeah. And close up that lug. Right. No, didn't do a good job on that. That again. Yeah, there we go. That's more like it. Alright. Gonna get a little bit of lead room here for this cap. Okay. Let's go into pin 2 of the pentode. Just gonna check that on the schematic. Yep, here it comes. So, there we had the junction there with C8. Alright. And pin 1, see? Yep. there's the 0.01, and I'm going to pin 2 of the pentode. The grid looks good. I'm gonna have another connection on there, so I'm only gonna use one of the two holes for that lug. Yeah, that's good. Alrighty. Oh, nope. That was a dry joint. Let's get more flux on there. I gotta check these joints. That looked a little suspect. Kinda looked clean, but I was kinda like, that doesn't look quite right. That looks right. Yeah, that's a good one. All right. Yeah, gotta be very generous with the flux. These old tabs, so. Connect one lead of a 330K ohm resistor, orange, orange, yellow, to pin 2 of socket V2. Use sleeving, connect the other lead to lug 2 of terminal strip Q. It's gonna be, okay. So that's the other connection that I saw was gonna be needed on that terminal. And it's gonna go into Q, which is this guy right here. So it's gonna go from there to pin 2, which is the ground. So check that on the schematic. It's going to be going, yep, there it is right there, from pin 2 to ground. And so that's going to be for the grid bias. No problem. It says use sleeving. I guess it should use a small piece of sleeving. I'm not going to go crazy. So I'm not going to have too much of that showing. It's going to snake around back there. Back side. And back end here. Oh, I'm going to go above. I'm going to usually go above that wire. Curl that around. Okay, this is a Homer moment. I looked at the camera to adjust it and saw that the red light wasn't on. I was like, I didn't turn off the camera. What happened? Then I looked and said, card full. So first lesson about, I never thought I'd need to fill both of the SD card slots in this new camera. Well, turns out you can burn through 16 gigabytes without knowing it. Problem is that when you're just one person, I don't have a camera operator, so you kind of have to be operating the camera and all the functions of the camera and monitoring the camera while you're actually focused on the work. Now I've got a monitor here on the side because when I'm shooting on the bench, the camera's over my shoulder, so I can't actually see the camera monitor right there. I'm looking at this secondary monitor down here, which will show the framing of what I'm shooting at, so I can kind of glance over and look at the framing while I'm working. But it doesn't have any of the data on it, so if the camera stops recording because it's card's full, it doesn't show up there. And so I realized, it was only after I looked back at the camera that I realized that the work I've been doing for like the last 45 minutes wasn't even recorded. Nothing I said, nothing I did. All this assembly here that I was doing here. So all this work wasn't recorded, including my wire stripping bonanza, because I went through and stripped all this wire using my wire stripping kit. And I showed how quick and easy it is to do a whole bunch of wire. So you didn't see that. So all that's lost. But yeah, I tied some resistors, the capacitor, and you know, did really good work on the solder lug here, and I showed how I didn't solder these connections because I knew, I looked ahead and saw that I'd have to make other connections, so I left them unsoldered and then went around, did these connections and did that, and I stripped the wire, yada yada. All that you didn't see because the SD card filled up. And now I got two SD cards in here, fresh, clean, so now I've expanded it to 30 gigs. I just can't imagine shooting 30 gigs of footage for like one video. It's just, I'm gonna boil this down. I know at this, I haven't even gotten through page 13, and I know it's already over 2 hours edited down. So it's like, I'm just gonna have to leave out a whole bunch of stuff, probably. I'm looking ahead. It's all a bunch of all these wires that I stripped. I'm gonna be putting these on terminal connections, and that pretty much gets me almost to the bottom. So, I'm gonna see if I can get through. Let's see if we can finish this up, and hopefully I can edit it down to be an hour. Is that gonna be possible? I've been soldering for 4.5 hours. Oh man. Yeah, these Heathkits take a long time, you know? Trying to take the spirit of doing something like this and condense it into, like, a YouTube video. If it's a 16-hour build or a 20-hour build, you know, how do you put that in a digestible video, you know, and make it, and give it the spirit of that pace, you know? If you condense it all down and speed it up, like some younger people like to speed up the playback rate to like 1.5 or 2.5 times, it's like, well, it's like, okay, fine, you're making it compatible with your life speed, but you're missing the point of the video. It's edited slowly because you're not supposed to chug it, you know, you're not supposed to just chug it down in one shot. You're supposed to, the pace of it is all part of the whole thing. You're supposed to take your time, you're supposed to relax and chill, take the time. It's like, it's like reading a book, you know? What's the point of reading a book? You know, it's the whole idea of taking it slow, savoring it, you know? It's the difference between having a meal last a little while or, you know, just inhaling it, you know? All right, let's get back to this, see if we can finish it up today. What you would have seen, I pre-cut all this wire. So I had a bunch of wire connections, and I skipped ahead, measured them out with my straws, cut them, stripped them, and the first one is a 4-inch length of wire. It's going to go one end to pin 7 of V2 here. Pin 7 of V2, and it's going to hang loose, because that's going to be going to one of the front panels. So, pin 7, V2. Next one is a 4.5-inch wire. I'm going to do to put to pin 6 and hang it the same way. And those are going to be hooked to the chassis later on. Okay. And a 2.5-inch length of wire that I pre-cut. And that's going to go lug 1 of switch S1. Oh, okay. Lug 1. switch S1, so that's one there. Okay. I'll have to give that a little sanding. Flux on that. Alrighty. That's a good connection. Alright. Well, this wiring's gonna go very quickly. Alright, let's cross that off. Next one is another 4.5. 4.5 inch wire that I cut already. First is going to lug one of condenser C7 over here. Lug one, which is this one here. Alright, and that's going to be going through the chassis here, through this hole here, and connecting to, through the hole and then through lug two of terminal strip T on the bottom side of the chassis, which is this one right here. So, no problemo. Okay, that's the only other connection on there, so I can, after I solder that, I can cut that short. All right. Trim that off. Alrighty. So now our capacitor is all wired up, all three capacitors. Alright. So it's going to be coming up to terminal 2. Let's go. Right. And I see from the drawing that I'm going to have some other connections in there. So I'm going to solder that down, but I'm not going to close the lug. I'll leave it open. All right. And the next one is gonna be 5.5 inch wire. One end is gonna be the lug two of terminal strip T, and it's going to bring it to connect the other end to lug 2 of switch S1. Seems like kind of overkill with the length. Unless I do it through the back, actually, I do it through the back end. I don't know. Just seems like it doesn't really have to be that long to do that, but seems like overkill. Overkill. I can't get to sleep. Think about the implications. Diving in too deep. And possibly the complications. Especially at night. I worry over situations. I know we'll be alright. It's just overkill. How many people know that song? Right. Alright, feed that through here. Alright, it's getting serious. Seen better solder joints, but it seems like it's holding. Yeah. All right. Yeah, it was definitely overkill. Minute work style. Colin Hay style. Total overkill. Alright, but it's done. Alright, getting close to the end of the page. Alright. Last wire I have, 5-inch wire. Connect one end to lug 2 of terminal strip L. It's this one here. Right there, so that. And I'm not going to close that loop because I'm going to be soldering other things onto this lug, so I can leave that open. And the other end of this wire goes to lug 4 of switch S1, which is that lug right there. Sandpaper. What did I do with the sandpaper? Oh, there it is. Got it. Shiny enough. Should be able to get some contact on that. Again, that wire length is total overkill. I do not understand why they want that so long. Total overkill in the length. Get a good joint. Alrighty. Alright, that's the wires. Okay, the next is I'm going to be hooking up the diode. Connect the cathode lead of silicon diode to lug 2, S3, and the other lead to lug 1, S2, of terminal strip T. It's down here. Oh yeah, okay, so this is where we're going to be putting our rectifier. So there's the hot coming out of the transformer. That's the 120 volts coming out the secondary. And that these outputs here, these leads are going to be for the DC. I'm going to check the schematic here, and yep, so we're going here. Red. Yep. People are saying Scotch-Brite's a lot better for that. Yeah, I know, but as I explained, all my Scotch-Brite is packed up at the other shop, so. So, question is, what would happen if you got this diode in backwards? What would happen? Well, pretty much nothing, because you'd be inverting the polarity of the power supply, running it on negative voltage instead of positive voltage. Check the physical connection there. Probably not the best joint I've ever done. Flux. Ok, get confused about which way the diode should go in a power supply. About which is the anode, which is the cathode. Just think of the banded side, which is the cathode side, is always going to be pointing towards the direction of current flow. So current is always going to be going towards the cathode. It wants to get back to ground. So in a positive power supply, we just have a single rectifier. The current flow coming off the hot lead, we want to get the positive flow going forward. So if you think of the top end of this diode is going to ground, it's going from plus to minus, the cathode is always going to be pointing towards the negative, or the ground in this case. So that's the current flow. Even though it's not going to ground, eventually, as it goes through the whole circuit, it is ultimately heading to ground. That's where it wants to go. So, yep. That's in. Original diode. No worries. Cross that one off. We got one more step. Gotten all through page 13, yada yada yada. We got one more to go. Alright. Pass the line cord through hole M here. So we're actually going to get the line cord out and hook that up. So here we got, you know, input coming in here. So so these terminals, this is going to be all the hot end. So we've got the output here with the diode, got the output from the transformer. And so on this other block, we're going to have the leads going to the transformer. So we have the black side there. So we got the primary on this side, we got the secondary on that side. Checking out this cord to see if we should really use the original cord. And it feels okay. It's still pliable. It's got the original Heathkit twist tie on there. Original Heathkit twist tie. But feels all right. Feels all right. So I'm going to use it because it's got the original molded plug. None of this polarized, grounded plug nonsense. This is the way plugs were back in the day. Put it in any which way you want. Ground. You got ground outside. What do you need it in a plug for? There you go. Exactly. Although I am going to, I'm going to make some fresh ends. You can see they cut through the insulation there, so I'm going to shorten the plug a little bit. Because when they strip this out, they actually open that up a little. So I'm just going to take a little bit of the cord off, cut it back. Strip some new ends. I'm going to feed it through first. Right. And now I'm going to strip it. Right. So one, it doesn't matter which, because again, this is it's not going to be, so one's going to go to lug one here, and then the other end is going to go to lug two of strip L. There we go, 1 inch. One, I'm going to do this one at a time. It's going to be easier, otherwise I'm going to just pull the one out when I'm trying to do the other. I'm going to close this lug. those are on. All right. Got our mains hooked up. And that concludes page 13. And I know the next thing is going to be doing the grommet thing. Well, they call it a cord strain relief. I absolutely hate these things. But they say use a pair of needle nose. You can get that through, no problem. Well, let's see. Get my good needle nose out. One of my oldest tools. This big needle nose. I've had this since probably since the late 70s. Yeah. Yeah. I wonder if this is gonna crack the insulation on this old wire. Debating whether to cut down the strain relief. I'd like to actually cut some of that off to make it not quite do such a drastic turn. It's more apt to just crack the insulation and end up causing a short. If I cut that down a little bit, it wouldn't crush the wire quite so much. It would still do the strain relief, but it wouldn't probably break the insulation. So I'm inclined to do that. Take off just a little bit. All right, that was clean. All right, so that should work. Done soldering, so I'm actually gonna take off the gloves. So that way, it'll still dig into the wire, but it won't do it so violently. Actually, it's gonna be a lot easier just to use a standard plier, probably. I know it says use a needle nose, but pliers. I think that the big ass jaw pliers are gonna be a lot easier to do this than. The trick is getting my finger out of the way so I can actually get the frickin'. They might call it a strain relief, but it's sure putting a strain on my sensibilities. See, now I got it in, but now I have to take my finger off to get the plier on. And it's gonna pop out the slot. Yeah, now it's out of the slot. I'm gonna have to crimp it to get it started and frickin' ass. Here we go. Just crimp it to get it started. And then I can move it. There we go. Get that end in. That doesn't seem like get to lean into it with all my weight. Ah, man. I wouldn't call that a strain relief at all. There it is. It's in. And it's like, and so now, you know, the curious thing is, well, they made you attach the cord. But this chassis is going inside of the case. How are you going to get the cord through the case? Well, turns out they put a super big ass hole on the back so that you could just put the plug right through, right? And then screw the chassis on, so that's going to screw on right there. So, no worries. They worked it out. Ah, there you go. Completed chassis minus some video of me doing the corner. It was so, I mean, you missed out on some. I mean, I was so in the zone doing these resistors. And getting that capacitor. I was thing of beauty. I wish you could have seen it. There you go. We have completed up to page 14. So when we pick it up the next part, which looks like it's going to be the tuning eye assembly. And we're going to be building a wiring harness out of this multi-core wire here. And building the probe. That's going to be exciting. And final assembly. Looks like a five-parter. And then testing. So, I don't know. This took a long time. These two pages. I started 5.5 hours ago. Yep. On these two pages, 5.5 hours. That was taking my time double checking, and of course I had to dump video because I ran out of card space, but we're up to tuning eye time. Alright. That's it for number 3. I don't know how long this is going to be once it's edited. I know I shot a lot of footage. I've been up here a long time. That took a lot longer than I thought it would for 2 pages. So chassis is all assembled, and so we'll pick it up tomorrow with part 4. Maybe a part 5 too. I don't know. This is going to be a long build, but it's all part of the Heathkit tradition. I've got a couple of days to get it together by the 1st. So we'll see how it goes. Hopefully by the 1st I'll have it tested, and we'll be putting it through its paces and doing maybe a video just on using the signal tracer for tracing signals and using it as an audio amplifier. Looking forward to that. So yeah. Anyway, I'm Fran. Thanks for watching. Thanks for hanging in for this long series, this nostalgia Heathkit build. Taking my time. This is probably the last Heathkit I'll ever assemble in my lifetime. Who knows? Anyway, thanks to my patrons for hanging in there and supporting the channel. You guys really rock. Anyway, I'm Fran. I'll see you next one, number 4. Bye!